Now, 50 years ago, the first ever Brighton Festival took place. Over the last five decades, this month-long annual celebration of the arts has become one of the city's most enduring symbols of inventiveness and celebration. Well, this year looks set to be no different. And joining me now to talk about this year's Feast of Festival events, its latest's very own Andrew Kay and Carole Britten from the festival itself. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How exciting is May in Brighton?
Exciting and busy.
It's wonderful. It's just the best, really. I don't think there's anywhere like it. And the sun's come out just in time. So
exactly.
We're very excited.
So the festival's been going 50 years. Has it changed much in 50 years, Carole?
Well, what's been interesting this year has been to look back and to reflect on that. And actually, in a way, the spirit of the festival has always been the same. It's been about bringing great art to the city, but also celebrating the residents and the city itself. And so bringing together perhaps what's seen as sort of fun with some very high quality art from around the world, and that's what we're doing again this year, and we're very excited to be bringing so many new things. We're commissioning more things than ever, and actually from this year particularly celebrating many Brighton artists alongside some really wonderful international partners and visitors.
Now, Andrew, at the same time, of course, we have the Fringe. A lot of people get very confused as to what the difference between the festival and the Fringe is. Can you explain what the difference is?
Well, the festival is the core festival and the original festival, and there was a point when the Fringe was created to emulate what was happening in Edinburgh. Fringe tends to be smaller productions, lower budgets, very exciting, but really the core of Brighton Festival, for me, is the festival proper, and it's what I'm interested in.
Do they compete with the two? Would it be better if the Fringe was at another time of the
year? No, I think they work really well together. I think they have a good relationship, and I think that's important to stress. But I think, for me, I want to go and see these big shows, the big international shows that come over with the festival proper, and it's very exciting. I think what's interesting for me is this is my 30th Brighton Festival.
Good Lord, are you that old?
I'm ancient. When I first started going to the festival 30 years ago, there was always a theme, and after a while that idea got dropped. Now I sense that with a curator or a director, they discover a theme. It emerges out of what they find and put together. It's not something that's forced on them, but it's just something that grows out of their thoughts. Do you think so, Carole?
This year we've particularly felt it was very fitting that the theme should be home. And that's the theme that our guest director, Laurie Anderson, who's an amazing, innovative artist who has been performing professionally almost as long as the festival has been going, she really took that to heart. And as have a number of the artists, to really celebrate a sense of place and sense of home when so many at this time are wondering about home and whether they have a home and where their home might lie. It feels very pertinent to be focusing on that and to celebrate Brighton as a city that really embraces so much. And yes, as Andrew says, the guest director that we've had since 2009 has really brought their own sort of flavour to each festival, brought something special, something different, so that we can keep sort of reinventing and revisiting everything. It's been a really fantastic innovation, and this year I think Laurie's brought things from a festival. A concert for dogs.
Yes,
I can't wait for that one.
Do the dogs perform?
The dogs are the audience, so you had to have a dog to book a ticket, and it was the fastest thing that booked out in the festival, so she kindly agreed to do a second concert for dogs. So there are two concerts for dogs.
What sort of music is in a concert for dogs?
Well, music that dogs can enjoy, so we shall see.
So that's very high-pitched.
Perhaps. It's certainly at a pitch that dogs will hear. And that's on the same night that she also talks at the opening of the UK tour opening of her film Heart of the Dog, which talks through her relationship with her much loved dog, but actually it's much more about love and longing and loss. It's a beautiful film. So she's bringing something for everyone this year. So as I say, from dogs to some wonderful concerts herself
and to lions. We've got
to
lions.
Maybe we have got a lot of animals.
Until the Lions. What's that all about?
Actually, another commission. We're commissioning a dance performer called Akram Khan, who is actually taken part of the story of the Mahabharata, and is telling that story, bringing that to
Let's
life.
Let's have a little look at that then. This is Until the Lions.
and scars with coal, with curcuma. I'm head to shank in ancient hate, in cast iron memory.
Looks very powerful.
It's wonderful, actually. I saw it at the Roundhouse. I'm very excited that we're able to bring it to Brighton, and it will be in the concert hall, beautifully staged, and with some wonderful music. And he's an amazing dance artist. And that's in the last weekend of the festival, at the same time that we will also be celebrating one of Brighton's wonderful history stories about that happened 100 years ago. So not 50 years ago, but 100 years ago during the Great War, when 2,000 Indian soldiers were brought to Brighton, and the Brighton Dome and the Royal Pavilion was transformed into a hospital. And we have come together with the 1418 Now organisation and Nutcut to produce a memory of that time, which will happen in Royal Pavilion Garden. There'll be a concert in the concert hall. There'll be live performances in the garden under the banner of Dr. Blighty. That's just one of quite an amazing array of, as I say, special commissions and things that will just appear. So if you're wandering through the Pavilion Garden at the end of May, you will come across that wonderful story.
So Andrew, how do people actually find out what's going on? Because there are so many things happening in Brighton in May.
If you've not seen this, then you're not living in Brighton. And it is the Bible of what's happening in the festival. But also this week we have an 11-page supplement in Latest 7 magazine, which is full of the highlights that we thought worked really well. I think it's really important to stress that although it's an art festival, it's a fun festival. And I think a lot of the criticism is waged against the festival for being a little bit highbrow. But I think it's the fault of people for not digging deep enough into this and finding the fun, and also finding how much of this program is free and open to the public. And I think you need to get out there and have a look and read it properly. Don't just flick through and say, oh, opera, oh, classical. Dig a bit deeper and find those shows that you can go to for nothing. There's so much fun. I mean, and in the things that you do pay for, there's fun as well. I mean, we've got the systems of
Our Ladies.
Yes, let's have a look at that.
That's from the National Theatre of Scotland.
Perhaps we can talk over it while we're having a look. Our Ladies, here we come. Oh, we haven't got that.
I think this is going to be one of the highlights of the festival, because I have it on good authority. Mr. Compton himself has told me that it's absolutely filthy. And if Andrew is saying it's absolutely filthy, it must be really rude. But I believe it's very beautiful as well. His wonderful singing.
I mean, it's everything from classical to ELO, and these are 16-year-old girls on a Catholic schoolgirls on a choir tour, and it goes through everything that you might imagine could happen on a choir tour, what stays on tour. And it's been adapted by Billy Elliot's Lee Hall, and he was really so taken with the original script, and he just felt he had to turn it into a piece of musical theatre. So there's lots of songs, sex and sambuca, apparently.
Fantastic. What's going on with that?
Sounds like my kind of night out.
I also love the fact that we get things like puppet theatre from South America, which I think is going to be very exciting to see.
A beautiful piece of very intimate puppetry that really is looking and tells the stories of the Chilean miners. It's from Santiago, from a lovely company, and Chiffon, Silence of the Coal. And there are just a few tickets left for that.
So these miners were trapped underground in Chile
and this is a piece that's responding to that through puppetry. It's absolutely beautiful. I think we've got a little bit of a clip showing now. And this is something that, yes, we've brought specially over from South America. So as Andrew says, yes, we do. We try to bring things from all over the world. But we also, have almost, I think, 32 free events this year. So there are so many things that you can see, and over 100 events where tickets are very reasonable, £10 or less. So there's so much you can do in the 23 days, over four weekends at the festivals here. And again, we do like to take you to unusual places and discover the city in new ways. So we've unearthed some interesting journeys through allotments.
Fantastic. We'll come back to that after this short break. Let's take a quick commercial break. Welcome back to Latest TV's Big News Show, live from the heart of Brighton. Before the break, I was talking with Carole Britten and Andy Kerr. Andrew Kerr, you mustn't call you Andy, must
Absolutely
I?
Absolutely not.
That's terrible. About the festival. Well, you were talking just before the break, Carole, about a bit of Shakespeare, Journey to the Allotments. I don't remember him writing that one.
No. So this is actually, I mean, this is one of the unusual and performances where we take you on a journey somewhere. And this year we thought it was very pertinent, because it's the 400th anniversary of Shakespeare's death, to invite an artist who wanted to explore an unusual story of Shakespeare. And it was about an eccentric that lived in Brighton. He's called James Orchard Halliwell Phillips, and he was a Shakespearean scholar of at the time, and he also was an inventor. He apparently invented the heated dressing gown. And he lived in what is now would be the Rodale Allotments. And so the artist Mark Rees came to Brighton. He studied here under Liz Argus at Brighton Uni. And so we were excited to commission this performance. And he wanted to create a journey through the mind of James Orchard Halliwell and the various Shakespearean characters that he was scholarly on at the time, and also to tell some story about this eccentric man of Brighton. So you do go to the allotments, you do meet some knitted characters, and there are some participants from some of the allotmenteers, and this is a fantastic example of where the festival really does work with the community, creating and bringing some new exciting pieces of art for us all to enjoy and entertain us.
And create something that's completely unique
unique.
I've never met a knitted character in my entire life.
Absolutely. Well, you could win one potentially at the end. But anyway, so that is happening every weekend. You catch a bus from the centre of the town up to the allotment, so you don't have to find your own way, and you're taken on a journey. So, yeah.
And how lovely that it mentioned Liz Argus, who's also performing
in
the festival.
Yes, she's performing this year as well. As I
and
say,
Liz,
we're really
Liz is
celebrating.
An unmissable Brighton dance creator. She's fabulous.
And her piece called Slap and Tickle, yes.
My favourite Shakespearean moment is going to be this wonderful thing, All the Deaths, the Complete Deaths,
yep.
With Spy Monkey, who are one of my favourite troops, and they call themselves clowns, which I think is wonderful because I'm fascinated by clowns. But this time they're working with Tim Crouch, who's been a festival favourite for years now. Yep. His shows are extraordinary, the intelligence that he instills in what he does, but at the same time with an immense sense of humour. I can't wait to see what that lot
so
do
when
together.
You say complete deaths, what, yes. What's
every
you mean?
Every single death.
Every or single Shakespearean death.
There are 75, apparently.
I think that includes the death of a blue bottle.
It does, it yes. does, yes.
That doesn't seem that many, actually, 75 deaths.
Yes, it's interesting, isn't
it? It is, yeah. But then there are some other plays that don't have many deaths in them.
Yeah, that's true.
There's some comedies and some tragedies, and I think this will be...
And then there's
be...
Macbeth, which probably accounts around 70.
Well, that's just a bloodbath, and I think that is probably what they're depicting on this wonderful yes. cover image. But, yeah, I think that's going to be great fun. I can't wait to see that.
And that's just one of the theatre events. I mean, we've got so much theatre, as you say, and Liz Argus, and there's some real hidden gems in there, I think, and as you said also that there's some of them are there's some funny and there's some things that are really making you want to think about the world. And there's a lovely piece that's coming from Germany that I wanted to draw your attention to called Portraits in Motion, and it's an interesting piece, and it's apparently took everyone by storm in America at Edinburgh. He walked for 3,500 kilometres meeting people and capturing their stories on flip books, and he brings his flip books to us. Starting on Saturday.
Let's have a little look. Supposed to be funny.
It is.
Yeah. I think they're meant to be entertaining, and I think this is something
really
that people
touching and heartwarming.
People miss out on the fact that the festival, although it's an arts festival, it's entertainment.
Yeah.
Well, our guest
Never
director this year, so Laurie Anderson is quite. She's bringing some special pieces as well as the dogs. She's bringing two major concerts, and one of them is about stories. She felt that was really fitting to the theme, and actually she's now talking about it as being her first venture into stand-up. So we are expecting jokes. We are expecting some comedy. And there is lots to enjoy, and actually that's what it is all about. It's about having fun. Maybe it's about having serious fun, but we want people to think, we do want people to laugh, and we want people to really get involved with as much as possible and enjoy as much as they can of what happens in Brighton in May.
How much organisation does it take to create Brighton in May?
Well, it takes a lot of organisation and a lot of hard work, but there's a lot of goodwill, and we're really lucky because we are an organisation that works all year round. We run, you know, we manage Brighton Dome, we run the venues year round, and then we produce the festival on top. So it's great that we have all that expertise to draw on all year round.
So when do you start planning the next festival?
You must already. Already, the plans are already well ahead, particularly for those things that are new, the commissions. We have to start looking far into the future.
And a lot of co-commissions mean you're working with other festivals.
Definitely.
Around Europe, in fact, the whole world.
Yeah, and we have producers that really travel the globe.
So it's quite a jigsaw to put together.
Yeah, that's the trick, is actually how it all fits together, and to fit it into these 23 days is a piece of magic.
Well, it's a piece of magic how I fit it all into the 23 days with the number of tickets that I go to review.
So how many shows are you seeing this time round?
I'm not quite as many as last year. I think I did 35 reviews last year. The year before I did 45 reviews, and I thought at the end of that it was time to start slowing down slightly. But I think I'm doing 25, 26 this year, and that's just the main festival. I will do some fringe as well.
Do you get fatigued? Does it get to the end of May and you think, I just can't face seeing another show?
I'm totally energised by going out and seeing good theatre, and I'm energised by going out and seeing bad theatre, and I think this is something that people forget, is that as a reviewer you don't just cherry pick and go to things that you know are going to be great. You go and see everything, because how can you know that you've seen something good if you haven't seen something bad to compare it with? And I'm not saying that there's going to be anything bad in the festival, but as a reviewer, you need that balance in your viewing life.
But also, one person's good is another person's bad, isn't it?
Absolutely.
You know, just because you don't like something doesn't mean that somebody else might not love it.
No. Absolutely.
It's the surprise. I mean, that's what I always look for, is something different. And that's what's wonderful. Our audience tell us they like to try something different in May, and to really give something a chance. And that's what we hope. We hope we've brought so many events that you can just try and try something new.
So how many shows do you think you'll see?
I think I'll probably about 30, yes, I think.
Oh,
so.
Easily.
30 plus, yeah.
And how many shows will be in the bar after? A few more.
Maybe a few more.
And I will see you there for that as well. I think one of the big excitements is that we've got Complicité this year.
That's true.
First time in Brighton for some time, and one of the greatest theatre companies in the world, I think.
And what are they doing here?
It's a piece called The Encounter. It's Simon McBurney telling this extraordinary story
of
discovering a village in Brazil, and it's a really unusual piece of theatre that actually is all about the sound and taking you magically to the place.
So if you had very limited time in Brighton and you could go and see maybe one or two things during the course of the month, what do you think people should see? Let's start with you, Andrew.
I cannot wait to see Complicité, The Encounter, and I'm really looking forward to Dido and Aeneas. I think that's going to be magical. And my final tip, I think, would be Stella, Neil Bartlett's new play. I think that's going to be wonderful.
Very briefly,
I can't really choose because there's too much going on, but there are many things that are running all the way through, like Operation Black Antler, which is another piece of immersive theatre where you can get involved. But every day there are different events, and I hope everyone will just use the website and brightonfestival.org to find out what's on today and make the most of their time.
Fantastic. Carole, Andrew, thank you very much indeed for coming to see me.
It's
and
a pleasure.
Good luck.
Thank you.
I hope you have a lovely rest in June.
Yes.
And I hope that you see everything that you want to see and it's as good as you think it is. So make sure you come to the festival. It's going to be a month and a half, packed into 1 month.